गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी अबाउट किंगडम्स, किंग्स एंड एन अर्ली रिपब्लिक। सो एज इन फोर्थ चैप्टर ऑफ हिस्ट्री वी हैड सीन दैट हाउ अर्ली ह्यूमंस चेंज्ड देयर लाइफस्टाइल, हाउ दे स्टार्टेड लिविंग इन अ परमानेंट हाउसेस, इन परमानेंट सेटलमेंट्स, एंड देन हाउ दे स्टार्टेड लिविंग इन अ कम्युनिटी, which means in a small group of people. Then they started living in a society. And after that, they start to write, they learn to read, and then after, they started writing Vedas. After that, they divided themselves as per the category. In the society, they divided their self as per the category, as per their occupation or whatever work they were doing. So these all kind of things we had seen in the earlier chapter. So in this chapter, each and every chapter in our textbook is interconnected. Okay, if you understand the fourth chapter, then only you are going to understand the fifth chapter. So after started living in a community, in a group of people, there was a need of a leader to control that community, to run that community. Okay, so here we are going to see that how some men became rulers. Okay, so choosing leaders and rulers by voting is something that has become common during the last 50 years or so. How did men became rulers in the past? Okay, in this chapter we are going to talk about rulers who were ruling around 3000 years ago. This voting process to choose a leader for a country is supposed to be last 50 years or so. Okay, which means after the independence we are involve ourselves in this voting process, and then we used to choose our leader of the country. Okay, so some of the Rajans or Rajas we read about in chapter 4 were probably chosen by Jan or Gan. Okay, Jan, which means common people, the people. But around 3000 years ago, we find some changes taking place in the ways in which Rajas were chosen. Some men now became recognized as Rajas by performing very big sacrifices. They have to sacrifice so many things, wealth, health, whatever. Wealth, which means whatever the kingdom, whatever their property or anything, whatever wealth they were having, they have to sacrifice their health. Whatever the physical sacrifice they have to give, they used to give. Okay? So here is one of the very famous sacrifice or a ritual supposed to be known as Ashwamedha, okay, which was performed by most of the kings, most of the Rajas during that time. So the Ashwamedha or horse sacrifice was one such ritual. A horse was let loose to wander freely and it was guarded by the Raja's men. If the horse wandered into the kingdoms of other Rajas and they stopped it, they had to fight. If they allowed the horse to pass, it meant that they accepted that the Raja who wanted to perform the sacrifice was stronger than them. These Rajas were then invited to the sacrifice, which was performed by specially trained priests who were rewarded with gifts. The Raja who organized the sacrifice was recognized as being very powerful, and all those who came brought gifts for him. So in a way, this ritual or this sacrifice of Ashwamedha or horse is supposed to be performed by a Raja who wants to prove himself the most powerful Raja of that particular region. Okay, suppose he is having his own kingdom, but if he wants to spread over his kingdom, he used to perform this ritual. This sacrifice used to perform by that Rajan. In this ritual or in this sacrifice, what is used to be done by them? That they are having their particular horse, okay, and then they used to let it loose. मतलब कि उसको खुला छोड़ देते थे. And they used to let it loose to wander freely. Wherever that horse wants to go, it used to wander wherever it wants to. Okay, so if that horse is passing from the other kingdoms or in the other regions, from the other regions, so if someone used to stop that horse, which means that Raja of that particular kingdom didn't want that horse to pass through it, which means he wants to stand against the another Raja who was performing that sacrifice. Okay, so what will happen if someone is stopping that horse, which means they had to fight with that Raja, and then whoever will win will be the king of that particular another region as well. And if any of the Raja or the other king of the another kingdom is letting it go, if they are allowing that horse to pass through that kingdom, which means he is the most, jiska wo ghoda hoga, the one who was performing that ritual is more powerful comparatively to the other one who is letting the horse go. Okay, which means that they are surrendering themselves in front of the king who is performing these rituals. After that, when the ritual used to complete it, and yes, one another thing, the horse was supposed to be guarded by the Raja's men. Okay, the horse was guarded by the soldiers or by the men of the Rajas, so that no one can hunt that horse. No one can hunt that horse. No one can harm that horse. Okay. And the another thing, after the completion of this ritual, of this sacrifice, the Rajan used to invite to those who allowed that horse to pass through their kingdoms. Then they used to perform these rituals or this sacrifice with the help of specially trained priests for this sacrifice only, and they were rewarded by so many of gifts, very expensive gifts. And then the Raja who organized this sacrifice was also used to get some gifts and everything, expensive things from the others to whom he used to invite. Okay, so this is the particular one of the sacrifice which was used to spread over their kingdoms and to prove themselves that they are the most powerful kings comparatively to the others. So the Raja was a central figure in these rituals. He often had a special seat, a throne, or a tiger skin. Okay, his charioteer, who was his companion in the battlefield and witnessed his exploits, chanted tales of his glory. His relatives, especially his wives and sons, had to perform a variety of minor rituals. The other Rajas were simply spectators who had to sit and watch the performance of the sacrifices. Priests performed the rituals, including the sprinkling of sacred water on the king. मतलब कि जो पवित्र जल, गंगा जल जिसको हम लोग बोलते हैं, that the ordinary people, the Vaish or the Vaishyas, also brought gift. However, some people, such as those who were regarded as Shudras by the priest, were excluded from many rituals. So as I told you, there are people categorized as per their occupation. Okay, so those who are belonging from Brahmin Gun they are already involved themselves into this kind of sacrifices, then those were Kshatriya. तो वो तो खुद राजा ही हुए. एंड दी अदर आर्मी और दी सोल्जर्स. देन दी थर्ड वन हु वॉज दी वैश्य और वैश, दोज वर नोन एज वैश्य और वैश, दे वर बिजनेस मैन और दी ट्रेडर्स. दे ऑल्सो यूज टू ब्रॉट सम गिफ्ट्स एंड दोज हु आर बिलोंगिंग फ्रॉम शूद्र कैटेगरी. ओके, दोज हु वर बिलोंगिंग फ्रॉम शूद्र कैटेगरी विच मीन दासास एंड दासेस, दे वर नॉट एट ऑल अलाउड टू involve themselves in this kind of sacrifices or rituals. Okay, and one another person used to be there also. He used to be there as a companion of the king in the battlefield, jisko hum log simply language mein sarthi bolte, the one who used to run the chariot in the battle, jaise krishna ji the arjun ke liye. Theek hai, so many other small rituals also there, minor rituals which used to be performed by his wives and sons. So this is the complete method or complete process used to be there to show how powerful the king is, was there. Okay, sorry, the king was there. If he used to battle just cause of this Ashwamegha ritual, after that if he won, then also this complete performing of the rituals used to be performed by king as well as by the priest. Okay, so here is one of the thing given, which is varna. So this varna, which means the category of the people that we had seen in the fourth chapter. So we have many books that were composed in the North India, especially in the areas drained by the Ganga and Yamuna during this period. So these books were often called later Vedic because they were composed after the Rig Veda, about which you learn in chapter number 4. I told you in the chapter number 4 when I was explaining that topic of Vedas, I informed you that when the book of Vedas were supposed to be composed, that period of time was known as Vedic period, and whatever period was supposed to be there after the completion of the composition of Vedas, the complete period supposed to be known as later Vedic period. So this includes the books, the Vedas, like the Samaved, Yajurved and the Atharvaved as well. So these were composed by priests and describe how rituals were to be performed, and they also contain rules about society. So as I told you that this Vedas are also containing the category of people which was Brahmin, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. Nothing more than that is there in this complete box. Okay, here you can see it is written Brahmins, then rulers, those who were known as the Kshatriyas, and then Vaishyas, those who were traders, okay, farmers, traders, herders or businessmen, okay, and then at the last Shudras. So these different categories on the based on their occupation were known as Varnas, okay, Kshatriya Gan or Kshatriya Varna, Brahmin Varna, Vaishya Varna and Shudra Varna. Okay, so this category was known as just the Varnas. The next topic is Janapadas. Okay, we had seen that a person, a man who was ruling a particular region was known as kingdom. But during that time, that word kingdom was not at all known as kingdom. It was supposed to be known as Janapadas. Okay, nowadays we used to call it a state. Okay, we used to call it a state where the government is free from outside control. And in other words, we can say the Rajan or the chief of the Janapadas now had total control over the area where the tribe lived. Okay, the Rajan imposed laws and rules over the area he ruled, and which the people of the state had to obey, which means to follow. Okay, so here there were two types of states, the one which was Janapadas and the another one which was known as Mahajanapadas. So some of the Janapadas were there, those who were following republics, which means ruled, chosen, the leader supposed to be chosen by the people, by the voting process or by the mutual understanding of their complete tribe or a community. And Mahajanapadas was supposed to be ruled, was supposed to be following the pattern of monarchy. Monarchy, which means a particular ruler used to be there who was known as Raja or Rajan, and it became hereditary, which means the son of that ruler used to be the next king. Okay, so let's see about the Janapadas. The Raja who performed these big sacrifices were now recognized as being Rajas of Janapadas rather than Jans. Okay, the people who choose their leader in that particular region where this leader used to rule, that was known as Janapadas. So this word Janapadas literally means the land where the Jan set its foot and settled down. Some important Janapadas were shown in map number 4, which is on page number 49. We will see it afterwards. So archaeologists have excavated a number of settlements in this Janapadas, such as Purana Kila in Delhi, Hastinapur near Meerut, and Atranji Khera near Itat. The last two are in the Uttar Pradesh, which means the Hastinapur and the Atranji Khera, which is nowadays located in Uttar Pradesh, UP. And they found that people lived in huts and kept cattle as well as other animals. They also grew a variety of crops like rice, wheat, barley, pulses, sugarcane, sesame seeds and mustard seeds as well. So as I told you that it was supposed, the ruler was supposed to be chosen by the people, and then they started ruling that particular region, which was became as the Janapadas. They made these earthen pots, and some of these were grey in colour. Grey were pottery, red were pottery. There were two types of pottery during this time. Might be we will see in the next chapter about it. Okay, so other were red. One special type of pottery found at these sites is known as painted graveware pottery, PGW, painted graveware pottery, which used to be made with the help of ash mixing it. They used to mix the ash with the clay and then they used to make that kind of vessels or pottery to cook food. They were stronger comparatively the other potteries, which were the graveware pottery and the redware pottery. This painted graveware were quite, what we can say, stronger comparatively these two other potteries. So as is obvious from the name that these grave pots had painted designs and usually simple lines and geometrical patterns, and some of the region or tribes were following varli painting, which supposed to be made with the inclination of the single lines, and then they used to make triangles and fill it with the white color. They used to make it on potteries on the wall of their huts and somewhere else. Okay, that was very famous tribal art till today. On clothes also this varli painting used to be painted by most of the painters, those who are expert in hand painting on clothes. Okay, so this is the thing. The next is about Mahajanapadas. So Janapadas was supposed to be established near 3000 years ago, and this Mahajanapadas supposed to be established about 2500 years ago. So some Janapadas became more important than others, and they were known as Mahajanapadas. Why they were supposed to be known as Mahajanapadas? As we had seen about the sacrifice of Ashwamedha, so continuously after the performance of this sacrifice, this Janapadas, the king of the Janapadas, as I told you that it used to spreading its ruling its kingdom, his kingdom, sorry. So as this kingdom, this Janapadas started merging with each other, it made Mahajanapadas. Matlab ki ek ek cities milke pura ek state banati hai. The way the small small cities merging with each other and making a complete state. In that similar way, the small Janapadas merging with each other and making a Mahajanapadas. Okay, so some of these were shown on map number 4, and most Mahajanapadas had a capital city. Like nowadays, states are having a capital city. So many of these were fortified, and this means that huge walls of woods, brick, sorry, huge walls of wood, brick, and stone were built around them. So first, let's just see about the Mahajanapadas in this map. So wait for 2 minutes. Yeah. So about this word Gandhar, Hastinapur, Kaushala. Okay. This three and the another one is the Ang. This four. During this lockdown, if you had watched Mahabharata, then you completely aware with these four names. They were the very famous Mahajanapadas during the time when the Aryans started ruling. Now, who these Aryans were? Okay, they were the people who moved towards the Indian subcontinent, and they were basically originated. Okay, they were basically originated in the areas surrounding the Caspian. They were the people who used to kept cattle with them, and when they were in search of fresh pasture land, in search of fresh grasslands, they moved towards to the Indian subcontinent, and then they started living in our area only, in the northern plains of our country. And they and some of the group among them started divided. They moved towards, few of moved towards to the Europe, and few movers to the Persia and Austria, sorry, Afghanistan, and then towards to the India. So this way they divided in search of fresh pasture, and few of them settled in this major four Mahajanapadas. As they started living from Mahajanapadas to Janapadas to Mahajanapadas. Okay, that is why in that complete series of Mahabharata, the Krishna ji used to speak Aryavrat. Most of the characters of this Mahabharata used to speak Aryavrat. So what was that Aryavrat? The complete clan or the complete period was supposed to be run by Aryans only, and that is why it was known as Aryavrata. So Gandhar, Hastinapur, Kaushala, and Ang, they four were the major Mahajanapadas during the particular time for a limited period. And then the another, which was the Vaji, Magad, Panchala, Avanti, and Kausumbi as well. So this Kausumbi, Rajgriha, Vaji, Vaishali, these were the shifted capital of the particular Mahajanapadas. And just cause being as the capital, they became very famous during that time. So most of the capitals like Kausumbi, Rajgriha, and Vaishali, and the another one was also there, which was named by, wait a minute, Pataliputra. Okay, which was named by Pataliputra, which nowadays known as Patna. Okay, so these all Mahajanapadas were supposed to be located near the Uttar Pradesh or the UP, nowadays which is known as UP. Okay, which means near the river banks of Son, Bias, Satluj, then Ganga, Yamuna, and Sindh. this major rivers were there which resulted this Mahajanapadas to established. Why? Because they were having fertile land tracts, they were having forests, they were having enough amount of water throughout the year, they were having running rivers throughout the year, as this rivers most probably originated from the Himalayan mountain ranges only. That is why. Okay, the another thing we are going to see that about the word fortified. So this word fortified, which means a complete kingdom and the palace of the king where he used to live, it was completely protected with the larger size of walls, which most probably made up of wood, brick and stones. And this fortification, which is also known as this fortified wall, is known as fortification. This complete fortification used to build by the women, men and children of that particular region. And they used to help, they used to make it by their own mutual understanding. Okay, they used to make it by their mutual understanding. That forts were probably built because people were afraid of attacks from other kings and needed protection. Okay, so it is also likely that some rulers wanted to show how rich and powerful they were by building real large, tall and impressive walls around their cities. So also in this way, the land and the people living inside the fortified area could be controlled more easily by the king. Okay, building such huge walls required a great deal of planning, thousands if not lakhs of bricks or stones had to be prepared. This in turn meant enormous labors provided possibly by thousands of men, women and children, and resources had to be found for all of this. It doesn't mean that it was very easier to build fortification to show how rich they were and how powerful they were. That was the reason, but the main reason was to protect the complete city or the complete area where the king was ruling. So the common people, those who were living inside the fortification, inside the fortified area, they were having that mutual understanding that if some other king used to attack, to pehle attack kahan pe hoga? Towards the outskirts of the kingdom. Outskirts, which means the outer boundary from where the kingdom used to started. That outskirts area is supposed to be going to be target first, which means the common people was going to be hurted. So for their own protection as well, they were helping king to make this kind of larger size of fortified walls. If you don't know, then the largest man-made wall is the Great Wall of China. Then the odd number two, the fortified wall, man-made fortified wall, the longest second man-made fortified wall is of Kumbhalgarh, which is located in Rajasthan in our India. It is the second largest man-made wall. Okay, if some of you might be visited that place. So here is the picture of the fortified wall. Okay, and then the new rajas now begin maintaining armies, soldiers. They were paid regular salaries and maintained by the king throughout the year. As the army or the soldiers, those who fought for the king, for the kingdom, they has to be paid. Unko bhi to kuch milna chahiye na. So they were paid by the king only. And how they used to get their salaries throughout the year, so there was a source of income for Raja as well. He was getting gifts from the other Rajas, kings and even from the common people also. But the another source of income was the taxes. So as the rulers of the Mahajanapadas were building huge forts, maintaining big armies, they needed more resources and they needed officials to collect this. So instead of depending on occasional gifts brought by people, as in the case of the Rajas of the Janapadas, they started collecting regular taxes. So taxes on crops were most important. Why? Because during that time, most of the people involved themselves in the agriculturing field. So most of the people were farmers. So usually the tax was fixed at 1/6 of what was produced. And this was known as bagha or a share. Okay, they have to share whatever produced throughout the year they had on a particular crop. They had to give it to the king in a form of tax. And yes, whatever amount of crops or produces or what we can say, gold coins or silver coins or whatever rupees or amount of them the farmers used to give it to king, the king don't used to use that tax for his own benefit. He used to save it for the hard times, flood, drought, whatever was there, war, whatever was there. He used to save it so that during the hard times, the common people of his region, of his kingdom, they do not have to survive. Okay, so whatever storage of grains, pulses, whatever he used to have, he used to distribute in equal amount to the common people in his region so that they can also survive. Wo apne khud ke liye nahi rakhta tha. He used to save it in a store, in a warehouse to distribute equally to the others as well during the hard times. There were taxes on craft persons as well. This could have been in the form of labor work. For an example, a weaver or a smith may have had to work for a day every month for the king. So he don't used to collect tax in form of gold or silver from the craft person. In place of that, what he used to do, he used to allow them to work every single day of every month for a single day every month. He allowed them to work as his own worker every month, so that what will be helping to him, if smiths are there, what they used to do, they used to make tools and weapons with the help of metal, so that weapons or tools or shields banane ka jo kharcha tha wo bach gaya. The king don't have to import it from somewhere else, or he don't have to appoint a particular person to make that kind of tools and weapons. Okay, weavers, they used to make clothes or something which used to can get distributed in common people during the hard times, like blankets or shawls or any kind of things. So this way he used to collect tax in form of labor work. Then herders were also expected to pay taxes in the form of animals and animal produces. They used to give goats, sheep or cows or buffaloes, whatever the herders used to keep it with them. They used to give it in form of tax. Matlab ki agar in form of tax, if a king or a chief, the chief of the accountant demand to get one cow from the herder, then the herder has to give it in a form of tax to the chief or to the Rajan. And there were also tax on goods that were brought and sold through trading. So those who were traders, those who came from another place into the kingdom of that king, they had to pay tax. Whatever selling used to be there by them, they had to give a particular amount on their selling during the year in a form of tax. And the hunters and gatherers also had to provide forest produces to the Raja, like wood or fruits or any kind of things the herders or hunters used to give to the king in form of tax. So this way the king used to collect tax to run his kingdom and to pay salaries to the big armies and to protect his own kingdom. Okay, then the next is changes in agriculture. So there were major two changes in the agriculture around this time. As I told you that Aryans, those who came towards to the Indian subcontinent, they brought with them metal as well as chariots. So earlier the people of our country or the subcontinent of India was not aware that how to make chariots with the use of wood. So it will make easier for them to transport themselves from one place to another place for trading or for traveling purpose, whatever. So they introduced chariots to the people who Aryans. Aryans introduced chariots to the people of the particular region of Indian subcontinent, as well as they also introduced metal, which was known as iron. Okay, which was known as iron. And with the use of that metal, they started making plowshares with the use of iron in place of using wooden one. Okay, they started making plowshares with the use of iron in place of wood. So how it will be helpful to them? It will be make the work of for the agriculturing quite easier comparatively to the wooden one. It used to break down the heavy clay soil particles and could turn over better than with the wooden plowshares. So it will be making easier. It was making easier to transfer soil from the below part to the above part, and used to break down the hard clay solid particles into small particles. So it will be make easier for the seed to spread over its roots towards to the. It used to helping the seeds to spread its roots freely, so that the crop can grow easily and whatever the produce used to be there, they can get it easily. So second, people begin transplanting paddy. People begin transplanting paddy. This meant that instead of scattering seed on the ground from which plants would sprout, plantings were grown and then planted in the fields. This led to increased production as many more plants survived. However, this was backbreaking work, and generally slave men and women, which means dasas and dases, and landless agricultural laborers, which were known as kamkars, had to do this work. Okay, the one method they just shifted from wooden one to metal one. And then the another major change that they started showing the seed in the different piece of land, and after the seeds started getting its sprout, they used to carefully taken out that small piece of land, and then they used to retransplanting it from that main land of the farm, so that it can be easier to survival for the crop, as it is already getting its roots, its sprouts, it is already getting it. So it will be making easier for the seed to grow easily, to become a healthy crop, and then whatever the produce was there, it got increased. The number in the production of the crops, of vegetables, of grains, of pulses, whatever was there, it increased. Okay, and this work was quite lengthier. It was time taking work. So this work supposed to be done by the dasas and dasis, and the another laborers, those who were known as landless agricultural laborers, which means they were having complete knowledge of agriculturing, but they were not having a single piece of land. Okay, and nowadays this kind of farmers are known as landless farmers. Okay, they know how to do agriculturing, they know how to do farming, but they don't have a single piece of land. That is why they were known as landless agricultural laborers. The another name of that landless agricultural laborers is kamkars, and they had to do this work. The next topic is a closer look of Magath and Vajji. So I shown you Magath on the map number 4 on page number 49. So Magad became the most important Mahajanapada in about 200 years ago. So many rivers such as the Ganga and Son flowed through Magad, and this was important for transport, water supplies and making the land fertile. Parts of Magad were forested and elephants, but obvious for it was completely surrounded by foresters. So it is having numbers of wild animals as well in the forest. So elephants were made very majorly helpful for the rulers of the Magad. And why? They used to train, they used to capture this elephant, and then they used to train that elephants for the army purpose. And foresters also provided wood for building houses, carts and chariots. And besides, they were also having iron ore mines, which means they are having their, they were having their own mines. So they don't need to ask for the metal to fulfill their demands of making tools and weapons. They can easily make it, as they are have, they were having their own mines. So they were having iron ore mines in the region that could be tapped to make strong tools and weapons. Magad had two very powerful rulers. The first one was the Bimbisar and the second one was the Ajatashatru, who used all possible means to conquer the Janapadas. They spreaded their kingdom over around towards to the west. They spreaded their kingdom near the Afghanistan. They completely conquered the Afghanistan, nowadays which is Afghanistan. Wahan tak unka ruling tha. And towards the south, Madhya Pradesh, which is nowadays known as Madhya Pradesh, which means nearly about the complete South India. Okay. And then the another main important ruler was Mahapadam Nand. He was the another important ruler. He extended his control up to the northwest part of the subcontinent. And Rajgriha, which is presently known as Rajgir in Bihar, was the capital of Magad for several years. When the Mahapadam Nand was ruling, during that time, the capital of Magad was Rajgriha, which is presently known as Rajgir for several years. And after the declination of Nand dynasty, as Mauryans started ruling, it shifted from Rajgriha to Pataliputra, which is present day known as Patna. So, more than 2300 years ago, a ruler named Alexander, who lived in Macedonia in Europe, wanted to become a world conqueror. Of course, he didn't conquer the world, but did conquer parts of Egypt and West Asia, and came to Indian subcontinent, reaching up to the banks of Bias. When he wanted to march further eastwards, his soldiers refused, because as he wanted to enter in the subcontinent of India by crossing the riverbank of Bias, the first stage where he has to pass from the region was the Magad, and the complete Mahajanapadas is having a complete stronger foot army, as well as they were having elephants and chariots and horses for the war purpose. So they were quite scared to enter in Magad and to fight and to fought with the kings of Mahajanapadas of our Indian subcontinent. Okay, the another is a closer look of Vaji. Okay, Vaji was the part of Magad only. It was also very well ruled by Ajatashatru. So while Magad became a powerful kingdom, Vaji, with its capital at Vaishali, which is located present day in Bihar, was under a different form of government known as Gan or Sangh. Now we are going to talk about republics. Abhi tak, till the explanation of Magad, we were getting the information of monarchy, where the only single king was ruling the Mahajanapadas. Now we are going to see that how a single region was known as Janapadas, ruled by the people or by the republic form of the government. So in a gan or a sangh, there were not one but many rulers. Sometimes even when thousands of men ruled together, each one was known as Raja. These Rajas performed rituals together. They also met in the assemblies and decide what had to be done and how. Through discussions and debate, for an example, if they were attacked by an army, they met to discuss what should be done to meet the threat. They also discuss their own opinions. Then they come to the conclusion that how they have to tackle this war and this hard time to protect their complete Janapada. However, women, dasas and kamkars could not participate in this assemblies. So both the Buddha and Mahavira, about whom we will see in chapter number 6, belong to gans or sangs. They both were belonging from royal families, as their father were ruling a particular region which was known as gan. Some of the most vivid descriptions of life in the sangs can be found in Buddhist books. Okay, gan and sangs. Sangs were supposed to be known as a particular monasteries where a single or a particular religious knowledge, how to perform, how to spread and how to practice, used to be taught. And whatever the Buddhism religious books are supposed to be there, they had a complete description of this sangs in their books. So rajas of powerful kingdoms tried to conquer these sangs, and nevertheless this lasted for a very long time, till about 1500 years ago, when the last of the gan and sangs were conquered by the Gupta rulers, about whom we will see in chapter number 10. So as I told you that each and every chapter is interconnecting with each other. So whatever chapters are supposed to be there on the based on the life of king and how the ruling pattern was there in 6th standard, it will be helpful to you not only in your next chapter, as well as it will be helpful to you for your 7th standard and for your 8th standard. Okay, so here the complete explanation of the chapter was there. Thank you.